We welcome you to the tape ministry of Denton Bible Church. The speaker today is the senior pastor, Tom Nelson.
Well, I want to show you something this morning that will have a great impact on you in our study of church history. This is something that all of us have in some sense dealt with. I know that I did back in 1977. In 1977, in the church that I was in, a pastor came to pastor that church, and I sat down with him and I asked him what are some very foundational and fundamental and, to me, very simplistic ideas about Christianity. And lo and behold, found out that this man did not believe in the Trinity. He did not believe in the deity of Jesus Christ. He did not believe in the virgin birth. He did not believe that his death was substitutionary for sinners. It was nothing but martyrdom. Did not believe in the inerrancy of the Bible. Did not believe in the necessity of the rebirth, or that there was even a judgment. He didn't believe in the fact of hell. And it wasn't simply that he had a Bible that he had misinterpreted, but the very foundation of Christian belief, the Bible, he rejected. And he did not reject it because he was anything new. He rejected it because he had been well taught in his particular seminary. And he was one of a great many. And as a matter of fact, he was on the board for the ordination of all of the pastors that came through that seminary that believed identically to him. And needless to say, we separated and went our ways. And I thought to myself, as you have, if you have ever run up against this, I thought, where did this individual get this sort of freedom? Where did he get this latitude? Not to study the Bible and misinterpret it. We all do that. Where did he get the freedom, the latitude, or if you will, where did he get the liberality of a liberal to be so liberal in his standing astride the Bible and saying that is and that is not right? Where did he get that wisdom to stand as judge over the Bible as to what was grain and what was chaff? But he did it. It is called theological liberalism. And it arose in the late 1800s to the present, and it's going to be so enormous that it will form the next branch of Christianity. You will have, by the 1800s, Catholicism, Protestantism, and now the phenomena of theological liberalism. What it's like, when I was a kid, we used to read the Superman comic books, and there was a particular aberration of Superman that was called Bizarro Superman. And he was a Superman from a whole different dimension. And he looked like Superman in a vague way, but he was a bizarre representation of the real item. Catholicism agrees with biblical inerrancy. It's just not sure what is Bible and what is not. It agrees with biblical authority. It's just not sure who brings about that authority, the Bible or the Pope. So in that sense, a Protestant and a Catholic see the same way. We assume the Bible is true. We just reinterpret it. We interpret it differently. These guys are not people that hold to the Bible as true and interpret it differently. The very foundation of Christianity, the Bible and the fundamental ideas of the Trinity, deity of Christ, Adam, and all of these, they challenge as not even being true. And if you will examine their view of God, Christ, and sin, and salvation, they are almost identical to heresies that were condemned by the church in the first 1500 years. And yet they become churches on the street corners out there. Where did they come from? How did they arise, and how did they get so substantial? We're going to study the rise of theological liberalism, and I want to give you a disclaimer before I ever begin. When I thought about teaching church history, every area of church history just excited me. The area of universal or Catholic Christianity, imperial, medieval, Reformation, the church and the Enlightenment, all of these areas have their heroes and there are conflicts that we need to understand. This area did not excite me because it's dark, it's confusing, it's depressing, it is hair-splitting, it's gothic, it is no fun. So as I teach this, let me just say, in the first 15 minutes, you're not going to understand what I'm saying. I'm not going to understand what I'm saying, and probably the guys that said it didn't wholly understand what they were saying. I don't want you to try to remember the names. I don't want you to try to remember the dates. I don't want you to try to remember even what they believed. There's too many and they're too enigmatic. You'll never come up with it. I want you to act interested. Just smile, like, isn't he wonderful? Because if you can hang with me through this dark, and it is dark, and that's the way you felt when you studied it. When I studied it at seminary, I felt like I needed to finish and go bathe. I had just been into this deep error and all of this crud that came out of it. But if you'll hang with me for about 15 minutes, then it's going to brighten, and it'll get a lot better. So you stay with me, and I'm going to show you where theological liberalism arose and what happened, how the church dealt with it. Where it's going to come from is a kind of an equation. Let me show you. The philosophy of the late 1600s, early 1700s, and 1800s is going to come up with the idea that God cannot be known, neither can anything of the what is called the noumenal realm, of the area of the mind, God, the soul. You can't know it. It's going to combine with the idea of evolution and the science of the late 1800s and the idea that God is unneeded anyway. Even Voltaire, in his infidelity, still had to believe that there was a God because you had the need of creation. From 1859 to about 1871, we're going to have a fellow called Charles Darwin that even takes away the necessity of a deity, what, at all. We will have the phenomenon of evolution that is contested in 1859 and by 1871 is universally received as fact. We haven't found the missing links yet, in fossil or in form, but we still receive it as a fact. Evolution. And then we will see how the church responded to it, and they are going to take Christianity and put it on, let me give you a term, the Procrustean bed of philosophy. Back in the days of Greece, there was a thief called Procrustes. And he would take his victims, and it was, legend had it, he would lay them on his bed. And whatever didn't fit on Procrustes' bed, your arms, your legs, your head, he would cut off. And thus a term came to be called the Procrustean bed, that you would take a presupposition, and whatever didn't fit of that belief system subsequent, you would lop it off. We're going to see in Germany, there are going to be not evil men, they're going to be seminary profs that are capital T, they guys of what they believe. Fellows of the seminaries that American pastors study at, they're going to take evangelical Reformation Christianity, lay it upon the ideas of philosophy of the times, and they're going to lop it off. And they will produce what is called higher criticism on seeing the Bible merely as a document, not as anything inspired. The church in America will respond to this by doing a taxidermy of Christianity and taking out everything that is supernatural. Trinity, deity of Christ, salvation by faith, death, resurrection of Jesus, and they will reduce Christianity to the existence of God, the historical person of Jesus, the necessity of love and of ethics. And no longer will man be seen as constitutionally sinful. He's just kind of dumb. And salvation is not something constitutional of the soul, of a rebirth. It is the ethical raising of society, the social gospel. That will produce liberalism. That's where it comes from. Now, let me bore you for just a second. I want to show you what happened philosophically. In the late 1600s, you had rationalism. Rationalism said that God could be proven by reason. And by A is B is B is C and A is C, very good men sought to prove God by reason. That's called rationalism. After that, fellows came up that were called empiricists. And they said, no, they crossed out rationalism. They said, you can't prove God by rationalism because that assumes that your mind can stand outside of reasonability of data and draw absolute, unchallengeable conclusions. You don't know that your mind as an instrument can do that. Your mind is a lens, and it's relative to each individual as they perceive. Mind can't come up with rational ideas. That's the way they reasoned it. Okay? The group, the empiricists said, you've got to have documentation. You've got to have empirical things you can touch and you can prove. Those were the empiricists. Well, after them came this fellow, and he dropped a bomb. He's a Scotchman. His name is David Hume. He said this. He said, they're both wrong. He said, man can't know anything absolutely. He was absolutely sure of that. He said, you absolutely could not have any absolutes. He said that when you examined data by your senses and you ran it through your mind and came up with reasonable conclusions, he said all that you got was on the relative idea of your mind as to what was true. You simply came up with pictures of what you thought reality was, but there was nothing behind you to declare that your system was flawless. And thus, the idea of mind, capital M-I-N-D, of mind being able to stand outside of data and draw rational conclusions that were true, he said, you can't do that. Your mind is an organ that secretes thought, like your liver secretes bile. And your mind thinks what it has to because of the data it gets. You cannot say that your mind can stand outside of the system and draw absolute conclusions. Hume. Thus, your mind doesn't really exist. It's not absolute. And you can't even know that matter exists, only that your mind perceives it. And they would say at this time, you don't know whether you exist, whether the universe exists, or whether you are merely a daydream in the mind of an iguana on the beach. And that was called skepticism, that you can't know anything. Hume. There was a Dallas Seminary once, there was a guy that was going to sell something. And Jim Hill was telling me he was on a telephone, and he was looking on the bulletin board, and he saw this guy was going to sell something, and his name happened to be David Hume. And he said, I want to sell this. And some guy had written a note right beside it and said, I'm skeptical of this, as he should have. So Hume said, you can't know anything. Give you a little bit of trivia here. The skepticism of Hume reached a fellow in the 1900s called Salvador Dali. You ever heard of Salvador Dali? And surrealism, and he got into Humean ideas that you can't know ultimately anything. Everything is just a daydream. His stuff was picked up by a guy in California that attracted people to his movement by the idea that there was no reality. His name was Charles Manson. So thought ends up in earth-shaking stuff when it reaches into society. Trust me. Well, after Hume, this fellow came along. He is a German, little bitty fellow named Immanuel Kant. And the way that you can remember it is just by his name, Kant. He says this. He tried to recover knowledge at the expense of metaphysics. Now, let me explain that. He said you can know things, but you can only know them in what he called the phenomenal realm, the visible realm, the touchable things. I can know that this is here. He came up with a logical idea that you could. But he said you can't know things. That's the way you can remember Immanuel Kant, that you can't know things in what is called the realm of the nous, or the mind, the noumenal, or the above the physical realm, the metaphysical realm. The things of God you can't know. The things of the soul, the things of creation, you can't know. But you can know stuff down here. And so he hopefully improves skepticism to what is called the inability to know, agnosticism, that you just couldn't know. Well, after Kant and his divided field of reality, the phenomenal and the noumenal that you couldn't know, here comes this guy, George Friedrich Wilhelm Hegel. He was an exciting looking fellow, wasn't he? Gracious. Now, Hegel said this. Are you ready? This was a bomb that he dropped. He tried to recover metaphysics, and he did it in this sense. To know higher things, you don't have to know higher things because you determine the higher things. He said truth is relative to that generation. We can know truth because we're the guys that invent it. It's not a god. We are the gods. How's that for you? And he said this. Here's the way you come up with truth. It's all relative. He said that each generation comes up with a thesis of what it believes is true. The opposite and the opposing idea of that is called antithesis, antithesis. And what society will do is take the thesis and the antithesis, and they will historically compromise to a mediating position that is called synthesis. His thesis, antithesis, synthesis. And that synthesis will then become the thesis of the next generation. That will be a thesis, an opposing idea, antithesis, and then a new synthesis that will become the thesis for the next generation. And that way, you saw the evolution upward of metaphysical ideas. You didn't have to discover them, you formed them. And this spirit of history that formed these, this what was called a dialectic or an ongoing system of truth, that spirit of the age was called the Geist, G-E-I-S-T. Also, we call it the gist. You ever said that statement? Give me the gist of it. It means the spirit of something. He felt that the spirit of all creation was this ongoing thesis, antithesis, synthetical deal, and that formed the evolution of truth. So he recovered metaphysics because we determined what was true, and he felt that that Geist was God. He was pantheistic. And so people will talk about sometimes in philosophic studies about the bomb laid by G.F. W. Hegel and his materialistic, pantheistic, synthetical, anthropological, man-centered determining of the truth of that day. And he made everything relative. Hegel. Incidentally, do you think that this is an idea that had no results? Listen to this. There was a guy who came, looked at Hegel, studied him, and decided he was true. Every generation thinks the idiots of that day are true. That's just a fact. And a guy said, whoa, that's really great. He felt that the thesis of his day politically was monarchy. The antithesis was democracy. And guess what he came up with as the new thesis, the synthesis of the two? Give you a hint. The guy's name was Karl Marx. What was the new thesis? Communism. Communism came out of the political outworking of Hegel. So this stuff may be weird to you and I, but to fellows like Manson and to fellows like Karl Marx, it was not so weird. They embraced it and lived it out. It's just the nature of man, the sheep, that philosophy forms ideas and it's reflected by the arts, by morality, and by politics. The church that is meant to stand true doesn't. What it does historically is it trims its sails and mingles with the nations and learns their ways. So by the late 1800s, we have gone from skepticism under Hume, agnosticism under Kant, to relativism under Hegel. That's what people were believing. This guy comes out and he drops this empirical bomb on us that everybody believed. A fellow named Charles Lyell. In your handout, it's misspelled. L-Y-L-E. It's L-Y-E-L-L. Charles or Lyell. Charles Lyell does this. He measures the silt at riverbeds. And he says that this riverbed builds up silt over a certain time. Therefore, if I dig down, knowing that an inch of silt is built up over X amount of years, if I will dig down, that amount of silt will determine how old that riverbed is. Now, Christians at this time believed, by the calculations of a fellow named Bishop Usher, that the creation came at 4004 BC. And the earth, that's how old the earth was. Well, he did his measurements and said, no, I got far longer than that. He didn't enter into that, the phenomena of cataclysm or the flood or of anything. That's just his conclusions. Well, Lyell came out with a scientific, which was the guru of the early 1900s. He came out with this guru of science that says the Bible's not true. After him comes this fellow, and he dropped the bomb. What he noticed, he made a thesis. He noticed micro-adaptation within species. That if you had moths in London, the white moths would disappear because they couldn't be camouflaged upon the off the polluted walls, and the birds would eat the white moths and the black moths would live. Therefore, white moths would disappear and black moths would survive. Well, that's true within species. And if you kept going and kept watching moths survive and inbreed, you would get black moths, you would get big black moths, you would get big black ugly moths, you would get big black moths that look like, I don't know. But ultimately, you would just get fantastic looking black moths. You would not ultimately get, in time, a black moth becoming Shakespeare, see. And that was his leap. He made this incredible leap from microevolution or adaptation within species. He leaped to the fact that you had this ongoing process. Now, we didn't see it out there. When we look out there in society, what we saw is amphibians and reptiles and birds and monkeys and men. When you looked at fossils, you saw the same thing. It was Genesis. But the thesis said that there was this continual chain. Well, they have changed evolution now to where you have the quantum leaps, because we still can't find these supposed missing links. You don't see the continual flow of animals into this higher form. And it was a bizarre thing, but he set it forth in 1859. By 1871, it was received. And it is, incidentally, the foundation of Western man today. Do you know that? It's amazing that we have bought into this. I saw a cartoon once with this Christian ship shelling this foundation of this castle called Secular Man. And this castle is built upon this huge foundation, and running up from the castle are these little flags. A flag called abortion, a flag called divorce, a flag called immorality, a flag called relativism, a flag called war. And we're shelling those flags that are attached to this castle that is sitting on this enormous bedrock, and the church is not touching that, this ship called the church. Guess what the bedrock was? Evolution. See, that's the foundation of our day. I met with a young guy, a brother in the Lord, last week, that had just had presented to him, he grew up in a totally secular environment, the possibility that evolution was not fact. And he was amazed. He said, do you mean that the Bible will conflict with evolution? It's not fact? There's not a way to amalgamate them? I said, no. And the Bible treats creation and it does not recognize evolution. And his thought was, I believe that, but how can it be? Because we have had it presented for so long as fact. Evolution. Well, Darwin. And do you know what? If you backed up and looked at Darwin, next to George Frederick Wilhelm Hegel, his relativistic idea of truth going upward, his scientific view of species going upward, it looked like, yeah, Darwin, Hegel, truth. Philosophy, science. What did the church do? You had some fellows in Berlin where American pastors would study. And what they did was they took Christianity and they just assumed, obviously, Christianity is wrong with its assertion that a God in the noumenal realm has made himself known and that man can know him. That obviously is wrong, they assumed. And so they tried to salvage what they could of Christianity because they felt it had been demolished. And they took Christianity and laid it upon the Procrustean bed of Hegel and of Darwin. And they began to lop off what didn't fit. Now, here's what we got. This fellow is called the father of theological liberalism, Friedrich Schleiermacher. He's a seminary prof. This is not a wicked man, per se. He's a good moral man. He said this: Christianity and the Bible is not taking our minds into this document that is inerrantly revealed from the deity. Because these guys all had a problem with it. He said what biblical religion is, it's a feeling. It's a feeling of ultimate dependence upon God, but it's not documented by truth. It is simply a feeling that you get. And the Bible is not, Schleiermacher said, a document that is historically, scientifically, spiritually true as a revelation from God. It is merely a compendium of man's account of different men's total dependence on God. Abraham, Noah, David, and the classic historical figure of Jesus. And that way you preserved some vestige of Christianity as a thing of faith, of God, and of morals. After him, a fellow named F.C. Bauer came, and he took Hegel and applied it to the New Testament. Now listen to this. Bauer said, out of Germany, that Peter was thesis, salvation to the Jew. Paul was antithesis, salvation to the Gentile and complete freedom. The synthesis was Luke and John and their gospel of love. And so he tried to show that even the Bible had a Hegelian dialectic to it, and everybody said, of course. Bauer. After him, a guy named David Strauss demythologized the historical Jesus. It goes like this. That Jesus was a wonderful man who held to essential ideas of God and love and the dignity of the soul. The church has surrounded that idea with all of these fantastical notions to give him some sort of credence. And they have made him virgin born. They have called him Messiah. They have said that he is deity, that he did miracles. Let's get rid of all of these supernatural, non-provable things and get down to the essence of who Jesus is. A fellow after him, it's Richel, he said that we need to, and he coined the phrase, take the chaff out from the grain of the Bible. And he reduced the Bible down to God, Christ, the dignity of the soul, and love. Julius Wellhausen, after him, he analyzed the Old Testament Pentateuch, the first five books, and said, one man didn't write these. It is not a revelation from God. Right here, the name of God is Jehovah. Here, his name is Elohim. We'll call this the E author and this the J author. Over here is the idea of the approaching of God through blood. We'll call that the priestly document. And over here is the higher notion of God as love. We'll call this the Deuteronomy author, which was, it's believed, from a later day. So they said. And so now you didn't see the Old Testament Pentateuch as Mosaic. It was J, E, P, and D, the compilation of authors. And people said, sure. And so now you had, now think about it, if you're a Christian at this time, you've got this philosophic bombshell called relativism, skepticism, agnosticism. You've got this scientific bombshell that supposedly is empirical from the studying of riverbeds and from the study of the species. You have this literary bombshell from Bauer and Richel and Wellhausen that you feel is true. American pastors went over and studied this in the late 1800s in Tübingen, in Berlin, those seminaries. They came back to Yale. They came back to Princeton. They came back to McCormick. They came back to the Baptist and the Lutherans and the Methodists with this higher education. What should they have done? They should have stood. They should have challenged the presuppositions that there is not an infinite personal God who can make man in his image, and his mind can come up with ideas, and when reinforced by the Bible that shows itself true in all of these areas, we can stand. They didn't do that. American pastors and theologians shaped the gospel to German higher criticism, and you came up with the social gospel. The social gospel is where we took everything that was supernatural, Trinity, deity of Christ, death and resurrection, second coming, and got rid of it. And we got to the fact that man is selfish and he needs to be societally raised. And what regeneration is not faith in the death and resurrection and a new birth by the Holy Spirit. Regeneration is where a society gets rid of the abuses of that society and brings about the kingdom of God. Some of you have, this got to be a big movement in America called the social gospel that brought about American liberalism. And there's a book that is written. Many of you have read it. And it was the social gospel. I'll bet some of you know who it is. A guy wrote it named Charles Sheldon. What book am I talking about? In His Steps. It became the most well-sold book outside of the Bible, even rivaling, I am told, Pilgrim's Progress by Bunyan. You read that book, and when you find the gospel, you come tell me. The idea of faith and the death resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who will return and judge, is not there. Sin is societal and institutional. Regeneration is collective and a higher sense of ethics. It did a taxidermy on the Bible. Well, what was the response of Christianity to this Jesus who was not God, man who was not sinful, the cross that did not save? One guy said, "We had a man without sin and a Christianity without a cross, preaching a Jesus who was not divine." That's liberalism. There was a response that gets into our day. Number one is that Christians in all denominations began to say, "Wait a minute." And the true evangelical Lutherans, Baptists, this is in the early 1900s, Presbyterians began to rally in what were called Bible conferences, where you began to have the great ideas of the faith preached and heralded. Let me show you who some of these men are. Harry A. Ironside. He would get up and they would have conferences at like Niagara, Northfield. Thousands of Northern Christians coming together to have defended the Trinity and defended the deity of Christ. Ironside would preach. Here's another fellow, C.I. Schofield. Some of you have Schofield reference Bibles. He was the great promoter of the idea of premillennialism because it was felt at this time as the century progressed on past World War I and you saw the world go to war, we are not going to bring about a kingdom. We're going to have to wait for the appearing of the Son of God. And now you had the belief in the second coming resurface called premillennialism. You saw this fellow, G. Campbell Morgan, one of my heroes, great, great scholar teacher. Saw another fellow, John Wilbur Chapman, fellow that led his singing, was a fellow named Lewis Sperry Chafer that began Dallas Seminary. Reuben A. Torrey that took over Moody Bible. And let me show you a picture of the conference. That is a picture of the Bible conference. You've got this one speaker. And that crowd out there would be all sorts of denominations, and they have come out from the unclean. And they would come to these conferences, and you would have all of these speakers get up and extol these ideas. In 1912, they turned out a series of books extolling, are you ready for this? The basic fundamentals of the faith. And the books defended them on the deity of Christ and the Trinity, the death and resurrection, virgin birth of Christ, salvation by faith alone, the second coming. They were called the fundamentals, and those who held to them within the denominations were called the fundamentalist in 1912. You also saw Bible institutes at NIAC, the National Bible Institute, Moody Bible, Gordon, where you could now send your kid and he wouldn't have to be infected with this stuff. You could protect your kid in what would become Bible colleges. You also saw, and he's one of my favorites, the arrival of the next great lightning rod who railed against liberalism and all of its evils. He's an ex-baseball player from the Chicago White Stockings. They said if he wasn't a evangelist, he would have become a great vaudeville actor. Some of y'all, if you're an old-timer, you remember this fellow, Billy Sunday. William Ashley Sunday, he said if you took hell and turned it upside down, it would say Made in Germany. Billy Sunday. He preached against booze, and he felt that if you wanted to be a Christian, that was the manly thing, the patriotic thing. He railed, you couldn't probably have had prohibition without Billy Sunday. This is the days before radio, the days before, obviously, television. And man, he was the best entertainment of the day. Sunday could preach. He still holds a record. Played baseball for the Chicago White Stockings. Circled the bases in 14 seconds. And until somebody beat it, I don't know who, it was an all-time record set by Billy Sunday. Converted because a little girl invited him to a gospel mission meeting. And he was led to faith. He was an old lecher who trusted Christ. Billy Sunday. Incidentally, have any of you ever heard of Charles Haddon Spurgeon? That name familiar to you? Charles Spurgeon in London preached so vehemently against liberalism that his widow felt it killed him. He ultimately died, and he was rejected by his own Baptist brethren who had received some of these liberal ideas, and Spurgeon stood until the late 1800s, and he died preaching against this stuff. You also saw, now listen to this, heresy trials. Presbyterians called four seminary profs in the early 1900s and was going to defrock them because of their condescending to liberal ideas. Heresy trials. So fundamentalists wrote, they rallied, and they even struck out in their denomination against seminary profs and pastors that began to teach this stuff. And yet the strange thing was that by the late, about 1930s, the liberals had taken the denominations, they had taken the conventions, and they had taken the seminary chairs. And so by the 1930s, the evangelical in those denominations was cast out. He ended up having to leave. As a matter of fact, in the Presbyterian Church, they took a great, great fundamental teacher named Gresham Machen, and they threatened church discipline against him for his disloyalty and crying out against liberal missionaries and against the denial of the virgin birth in Presbyterian circles. And the liberals were going to defrock him for disloyalty. I don't mean to be nasty, but the bad guys won at the denominational and the convention level. And so you saw the phenomena of separation. In the Northern Baptist, you saw in 1932, the General Association of Regular Baptists, the GARB, split. In 1937 or 47, you saw the Conservative Baptist Association split. You saw the Bible Baptist Fellowship, 1950, split. Up until that time, if you wanted to go to a Baptist church, it was just a Baptist church. Now you had the BBF, the GARB, the CBA. The phenomena of splits as fundamentalists came out from those denominations and started their own. We didn't see this down in the South so much, especially among the Baptists, because all of these were Northern ideas in Northern seminaries. And in the early 1900s, we didn't cotton too much to them Northerners. And I'll tell you why, because they'd shot your granddaddy at Chickamauga. And so the Civil War was still big on our hearts. And so we did not readily receive the Northern lies. All right. You also saw within Presbyterian circles, listen to this. The OBC, or OPC, the Orthodox Presbyterian Church, 1936, split. The Bible Presbyterian Church, 1938, split. The Evangelical Presbyterian Church, 1955, split. The Reformed Presbyterian Church, 1965, split to preserve evangelicalism. Gresham Machen started Westminster Seminary, a brand new seminary. It was said in 1929, the stock market fell and Princeton fell. Princeton rejected biblical inerrancy in their belief system. Princeton! I'm talking Jonathan Edwards, that was the president of Warfield, Hodge, Machen, Princeton. I've still got these guys on my shelf. Princeton rejected inerrancy. That's why Dallas Seminary was started in 1924 to 1926 in that area, was because Princeton fell. The liberals won. Among Methodism, you saw the Evangelical Methodist, the Southern Methodist, and the Fundamental Methodist split. In the Lutherans, you saw the Missouri Synod Lutheran maintain their conservative stance. You also saw the phenomena of what was called, are you ready? Non-denominational churches. by the non-denominational seminary that's down here on Swiss Avenue in Dallas called Dallas Theological Seminary that turned out this old scamp named Melvin L. Summerall that graduated there in 1972 that started this church in 1976. Or he went 72 to 76 and started Denton Bible Church. So it comes down to where we are. Are you with me? You see where we are by the mid-1900s? Catholics, Protestants, liberals, and all the evangelicals coming out of the denomination to form the phenomena of independence and splits because they won at the seminary level. Well, I could end right here, but there's one more little thing I want to show you that mutated. And if you are in Southern Baptist circles, this is the dilemma of the Southern Baptist today. Now listen to me. After the fundamentalists lost at the conventions and the seminary level, they formed their denominations, they began to huddle, and they became militant fundamentalists. Anything that was societal in ministry, they saw that as an extension of the social gospel and liberalism, fundamentalists pulled out of society. We started our own colleges, we pulled out of education. The liberals had the presses, they had the publishing houses, they had the seminaries. We did not involve ourselves in apologetics, in science, in scholarship, or in social movements. That was liberal, we thought. In the 1940s, the kids that came out of the parents of the 20s looked up and they said, we need to integrate out there in this fallen world and to be light and salt. A guy named Carl Henry got up to preach at a seminary graduation, and he said this. He said, we have become spiritually legalistic in fundamentalism. We have become scholastically inept and silent. We have become scientifically silent and withdrawn. We have become socially unconcerned. We have got a divided realm, he said, between God and reality, and we try to live in the sweet by and by, and we let the world go by. We are withdrawn and we are dead, fundamentalists. We need, are you ready? A new evangelical. And the term neo-evangelical was coined from Carl Henry in 1947, and a bunch of the young guys that are now retiring pastors rose up within fundamentalism and said, we've got to mix it. One of those guys was Bill Bright, studying in California, that started what organization? Campus Crusade for Christ is a neo-evangelical, get-out-there organization. Dawson Trotman of the Navigators, InterVarsity, the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. Christians began to mix it up. We began to retake the publishing houses. We began to come out with guys like C.S. Lewis, Francis Schaeffer, and we challenged evolution. We challenged the documentary hypotheses of Wellhausen. We challenged the liberal notions in an intellectual sense, and we regained a sense of dignity. What happened was our dialoguing with science and scholarship began to go too far, and you began to see evangelicals adjust their view on inerrancy to compensate the liberals. Well, what you saw happen in our day is what is called, it's the bad side of neo-evangelicalism. Early on, we would have called ourselves neo-evangelicals. They were not just a bunch of withdrawn militant fundamentalists. We get out there and win them, disciple them. We send out missionaries. We mix it in societies. That's what we would have called ourselves. Now you can't call yourself a neo-evangelical because of a trimming of the sails. The argument goes like this. Is the Bible inerrant? The neo-evangelical of the late of the 1950s, 1960s said this. Yes, it is inerrant. You're telling me it has no mistakes. Well, I'm not saying that. Yes, it has mistakes. Some of the scientific postulates of the Bible are wrong. Some of the complementary books, Kings, Chronicles, and Samuel, contradict historically. But you have to realize the Bible is not a scientific or a historical book. The Bible is a spiritual book. And what it says of God, Christ, man, sin, salvation is true. What do you think about that? Here's the premise. The Bible can't be trusted in elements you can judge, science and history. But it can be trusted in elements you cannot test, God and the soul. Do you buy that? If the Bible is wrong in areas you can judge, do you believe it'll be true in areas you cannot? Is God the God of the spiritual realm? He is not the God of history and science? See, that is a trimming of the sails to liberalism, and that happened. I'm not saying it shouldn't. I'm not saying that it couldn't. I'm saying it did. And this is what the Southern Baptist got infected with at every single seminary, and this is what the SBC is struggling with right now, is the modification of fundamentalism to liberal ideas. And the problem the Baptists are having, I'll get some letters on this, is that in Southern Baptist circles, there are a number of Southern Baptists who do not feel that that battle is worth waging war. Let's don't fight about this thing as to whether the Bible is true in all areas. We do agree that it is true in the areas of Jesus and salvation. Let's let it slide and go on. This, folks, is why when the Southern Baptists have their conventions every year, war breaks out between the guys that think it is important to uphold the standard and those that feel it is not. But if you will concede in science and history, I'll assure you, you are going to start conceding in areas of premarital sex, homosexuality, women's roles that is happening, and ultimately you're going to concede in the area of sin, salvation, and hell. Not only will you, it happened within Baptist circles. So this is the battle that we're fighting in evangelicalism today. The Bible is true. It may take some study, it may take some harmonization, but if there is an infinite sovereign God, it is true in all areas. Upper story, the soul, God, and salvation, and lower story, history and science. Our church does not hold to what is called the inspired purpose view of the Bible, a spiritual document and nothing else. We hold to a totality of the inerrancy of this book. That's where we are. I'm done. That wasn't too painful, was it? You see a little bit where these guys came from, where we came from, and why the struggles are. Tom, you're saying, are you finished? Got one more week for the arrival of one more solar body out there that as militant fundamentalists begin to withdraw, as the church goes dead under liberal ideas, you saw a pietistic movement within the denominations and within Christianity that took the teachings of Wesley and let them evolve into a second blessing that gave birth to the Pentecostals, which gave birth to the Charismatics, that gave birth today to the third wave, that God wants you healthy and God wants you rich. How do we go from John Wesley to Kenneth Copeland? Well, you come next week, and I'll show you how. The rise of the Pentecostals. Father in heaven, I thank you for a time that you can give us, short though it is, in the investigation of your dealings and what has happened as man has acquiesced, compromised, and ultimately denied the very revelation of God. On our present day errands that take a golden calf of Egypt and fashion it into the common idea of the pagan as to what a deity is and call it Jehovah who led us forth. And it didn't please you then. And it does not please you now. And the children sat down to eat and drink at its sacrifice and rose up to play in immorality then. And men rise up in immorality and a defeated life now because it simply is not a sufficient base of knowing you. Make us wise unto that which we believe as a fellowship. We'll ask it to the glory of Christ, virgin-born Son of God, our advocate, our blood sacrifice to the wrath of a holy God, whereby through the work of God the Holy Spirit we might be converted, placed in Him, His righteousness imputed to us, secured for eternity, awaiting the rapture and the second coming visibly of our great King to restore His promises to His wounded nation of Israel according to the inerrancy of the Bible. And we will ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.